All right, so we had gotten this far, and we have our definition of what standard deviation does, and we now know why the formula should be what it is. So I want to show you one example where I compute the standard deviation by hand, and then after we've done it by hand once, from then on, you can do it on the calculator. Basically, because you'll see how long it takes to do it for just a small set of data. And generally speaking, in statistics, since we're dealing with such large data sets, it's not feasible to do this by hand all the time. We would need a faster method. And so, you know, for tests or homework or things of that nature, where we're dealing with larger data sets, I'm not expecting you to do these computations by hand. When you get to the homework in the textbook, it will talk about using the defining formula and using the computation formula or something like that to come up with the standard deviation. And really there, please feel free to just do your computations by hand. Okay. So let's say that I had a data set, and let's say that my individual data values, my x values, are 1, 8, 12, 12, 17, and 25. Okay, so there are my pieces of data. For each of these, actually for the computation, the thing that I'm going to need to do is take each of these pieces of data and subtract the mean. So one thing that I need to know right up front is what is the mean for this set of data. So I would add all of those pieces of data up, 1, 8, 12, 12, 17, and 25, and we get a value of 75. And then I want to divide by, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 pieces of data. So we're looking at a value of 12.5 for the mean. Okay, and I'm treating this as though it's population data. Sample data, obviously, I'd be using the variable x bar here. And instead of having a capital N in the denominator, I would have a lowercase n minus 1. And this would be an S instead of a sigma. So again, watch those symbols. If you want to review any of those symbols, they're all on that purple sheet that I passed out to you in class. Okay, so now I make myself a column where I take each x value and subtract the mean. So if I start by taking 1 minus 12.5, I'm going to get negative 11.5. If I do 8 minus 12.5, then we have a negative 4.5. 12 minus 12.5 is negative 1/2 for both of these. And then 17 minus 12.5 gives us a value of 4.5. And 25 minus 12.5 gives us a value of 12.5. Okay, so there are all of our deviations from the mean. How far away are any of these pieces of data from the mean? Basically, this negative 4.5 here is telling us that the value of 8 is 4.5 units below the mean because it's negative. Then according to the formula, the next thing we do, we start in the parentheses, then we do the exponent. So now we're going to take all of these deviations and square them like so. So if I take negative 11.5 squared, whoops, I get 132.25. If I take 4.5 and square it, I get 20.25. If I take 0.5 and square it, we get 0.25. 4.5 squared would be the same as negative 4.5 squared, which is the 20.25. And then 12.5 squared, we get 156.25. Okay, so there are all of our squares. And then when we look at the formula, we need to take all of those squares and add them all up. So I'm just going to total them down here. 132.25 plus 20.25 plus 0.25 plus another 0.25 plus 20.25 plus 156.25. And we get an overall value of 329.5. So that's the sum. At this point, we've computed everything in the numerator. We found the differences between each of the x's and the mean. We squared them all. We added them all up. Whoops, Sorry, my paper went all cattywampus there. All right, now we need to take that total and divide it by how many pieces of data there are in the population, which there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we'll divide by 6. And then we take our 329.5 over 6. We get a value of 54.916666 repeating. Okay. And we want to square root that value. Oh, and of course the calculator I have right next to me has no square root function. Hold on just a second. Aha. Okay. So we take our value and we square root it. And we get a value of approximately 7.41 for the standard deviation. And this tells us that for this set of data, on average, any individual piece of data is approximately 7.41 units away from the mean. And whatever the units of the data set are, that's the same as the units of the standard deviation. So it has same units as data. If our data were measured in centimeters, this would be 7.41 centimeters. If our data were measured in joules, this would be in 7.41 joules. Okay, so whatever the units are. And the lower this value, the smaller the spread or the more consistent the set of data, the higher the value, the larger the spread, the less consistent the set of data. And that's the idea with the standard deviation. In the next video that I post, I'll show you how to do this computation on the calculator so that you don't have to spend as much time doing it by hand. You can see how long it took us for just 6 pieces of data. For a data set that has, say, 50 pieces or 200 pieces or thousands of pieces of data, this would be a really cumbersome process if we didn't have a better way to do that. Okay. The last thing that you'll see in the textbook talking about measures of spread is something called the coefficient of variation. And the coefficient of variation, basically this expresses the standard deviation as a percentage of the mean. And again, higher values with your coefficient of variation indicate more spread out or more variable sets of data. Lower values for your coefficient of variation indicate more consistent sets of data with less spread. The coefficient of variation is computed by taking if you're dealing with population data, you take your mean, or sorry, your standard deviation, sigma, divide by your mean, multiply that value by 100, and this is in a percentage. If you're dealing with a sample, the computation remains the same. It's just S divided by X bar times 100, so the notation changes. Sample standard deviation, sample mean. Okay. The advantage to the coefficient of variation is that this is a unitless measure. There are no units, except for percent, attached to coefficient of variation. So we can use it to compare the spread of sets of data that maybe were not measured in the same set of units. Okay. The computation is very straightforward. If I'm looking at the coefficient of variation for our last set of data that we were using for our last example, our standard deviation was 7.41 and our mean was 12.5. And if I do the computation here, 7.41 divided by 12.5 times 100 tells me that the coefficient of variation here is 59.28%.